you all for joining in on this news conference this morning. I'd like to begin with three topics. I think this is going to be a good day in South Dakota. First of all, this week the tourism tax extension was passed, and it made its way down to my desk, and I'm going to be signing the tourism tax as the first bill that I signed this legislative session. This, of course, is not a tax increase. It's a continuation of a tax that the industry itself supports and wanted. And it's largely paid by out-of-state visitors, and it does demonstrably produce increased visitor spending in South Dakota and helps us keep our other taxes down. So I'm very pleased about that, and I'll be signing that bill today. Secondly, on the House floor, the criminal justice initiative package of changes is being heard on the floor today. It came out of committee yesterday with a unanimous vote, and I'm very hopeful about that passage today on the House floor. Both of those measures, the tourism tax and the Public Safety Improvement Act, I think are good examples where both parties have worked together and supported legislation that's good for our state. And I'm very optimistic that that will find good support in the House today. The third thing I want to talk about is my visit with the Veterans Affairs Secretary Shinseki in Washington last week when we met for this news conference. I was about to spend some time with Secretary Shinseki. I'd been last week I was in Hot Springs to visit the VA facility there and to talk with the supporters of an effort to ask the Secretary to reconsider the announcement they made that they're going to be closing down the entire campus in Hot Springs, not just the domiciliary, but also the hospital and clinic and dialysis services that they provide there, and move those either to Fort Meade or Rapid City or to different locations in Hot Springs. And I met along with Senators Johnson and Thune and Representative Noem, and also Senator Johans from Nebraska and Senator Enzi from Wyoming. They were also present. The Save the VA Committee from Hot Springs made about a 40-minute presentation, and I thought made a very good case to the Secretary, and there was a good 45 minutes of dialogue after that, and I'm hopeful that the Secretary will consider some of the points raised by the Save the VA Committee and look at whether there might be some reason for reconsidering that decision to close completely the Hot Springs facility as it exists today. With those comments, I open it up for any questions you may have about anything at all.
Governor, House Health and Human Services Committee began a hearing today on a bill that, while it wouldn't legalize marijuana, would let people argue in court against possession charges that they needed for medical necessities if they're suffering from cancer or something else like that. Do you have any thoughts on that bill?
Well, I haven't seen that bill. I guess I've made aware of it this morning. Between the two houses now, there's about 500 bills circulating. So I've read most of the titles, but I don't, in concept, support the notion of a defense like that. I think it's tantamount to legalizing medical marijuana use. That's something even the voters have rejected, and that I personally reject as well.
Governor, any Any comments on the House passing the school sentinel bill, especially by a pretty considerable margin?
Well, yeah, I, you know, again, that bill, I think it's noteworthy that it is a work that is seemingly continually in process. It was introduced, it was amended in committee, it was amended again on the floor. I heard this morning from one of my staff that there's still another amendment that's floating around that will be introduced on the Senate side. And so it's hard to form an opinion on a piece of legislation that keeps changing. Although I must say, I think the amendments that have been offered have been improvements to the bill. I saw in the Argus Leader that there's 24 other states that allow this kind of thing or something less restrictive. There's some states I know I read where anyone with a concealed weapons permit can enter onto the school grounds with a weapon, a visitor, a staff member, anyone. So I think this, I'm going to be watching this. As I mentioned in earlier conferences, I think key to this is conversations with school officials and conversations with law enforcement. I'll want to listen to the debate so I can understand both sides of this this issue before making a decision, if it reaches my desk.
Do we have any questions from callers on the line? If so, we have one here. Virginia.
I was listening online to debate about Senate Bill 70, and I didn't finish hearing it before coming here, so I'm coming in with a half-baked question. But someone was raising the objection, and I did hear it before, that this Senate bill holds a whole lot of titles and a whole bunch of different actions, and he says that this is unconstitutional. It runs contrary to the state constitution. Could you address that?
I think that is something that people will sometimes raise if they're not familiar with the positions that our South Dakota Supreme Court have taken on that very topic. I'm confident that the elements that are within that bill would be upheld as constitutional by our South Dakota Supreme Court, because they've considered this kind of argument in the past and not accepted it.
All right, let's go to the phones. Do we have any questions out there? #6 to unmute, *6 to remute after you've asked your question.
Governor Tony Mangan at KCCR.
Yes, Tony.
Regarding the school sentinel bill, you said you would consider it if it reached your desk. Do you want it to reach your desk?
Well, as I said earlier, I think our gun laws in South Dakota are pretty good right now. I think they strike a pretty good balance between individual liberty and the Second Amendment protections allowing our citizens to exercise those same rights when they leave our state with reciprocity in concealed carry permits. Of course, there's been a heightened concern about this issue and school safety. The same concerns really can be raised about any location where people congregate, whether it's a theater in Colorado, as we witnessed, or a school in Connecticut where we witnessed a bad actor committing a tragic act. I guess I would want to look at the bill and see if it reaches my desk. It's hard to say I want a bill to reach my desk when I don't know what it's going to say when it reaches it, Tony. So I'm happy to consider any legislation that reaches my desk, because I know it will have been debated thoroughly by the legislative process.
Governor, is this one of those things, are you going to get involved in this as far as maybe working with sponsors and the legislators to address some of those concerns you might have with this bill before it would reach your desk?
Well, to the extent that some people have asked our attitudes about it, you know, my office has already offered some thoughts. For example, the notion that there should be training, that there should be interaction with local law enforcement. Those are some of the things that the police chiefs and sheriffs themselves raised with us, and that we in turn, I raised in this very forum. And so whether through this forum or in direct conversations with people who are interested in the bill, my staff is always open to offering ideas about ways that bills could be improved.
Do we have any other questions?
Some of the open government bills that have come before committee have seemed to have been hit or miss. They're about struck down or upheld 50-50. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I guess I'm disappointed. I was hoping that those bills would pass. We were in support of all of them. We were participating with the group when it was created. I brought in some notes on that because those that are still in play, I know one of them, 1108, had an amendment in the House that I think really cripples it, and we're going to be offering an amendment on the Senate side to, I think, regain the openness intention, but help to overcome the objections that were raised by some opponents. And so I'm hoping that will be seen as a good fix. Finding out 1110, which ensures that the public can find out how government information is stored, I think that found good support. The other two that passed, I don't know that there was significant opposition to them. The one that failed in the House, on the House floor, the teleconference definition, I guess I was disappointed in that because I think there is the potential for government organizations to circumvent the spirit of the law by using email and all reply and converse essentially in a teleconference meeting. And I don't know that there's going to be deliberate intention to circumvent open meetings. I would hope not. But I think it could easily evolve to that unintentionally by people just wanting to do what's convenient and thereby avoiding the important part of allowing the public to observe at the same time they're doing what's convenient. So I'm hopeful that that open government and open meetings will be a continuing effort. I'm hoping we'll see more in future sessions and that we'll still see more opportunity in this sessions for those that are still in play.
Do we have any other questions from callers on the line? If so, #6 to unmute and *6 to remute your phone. All right, if not, we'll call close to this today. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, everyone.